In the redox reactions in metabolism tutorial, we saw that many reactions in metabolism involve the transfer of electrons from one molecule to another. This transfer is an example of a redox reaction, in which an oxidation is coupled with a reduction. The atom or molecule that loses electrons is oxidized, and the atom or molecule that gains electrons is reduced. In this tutorial, we'll apply redox reactions to the electron transport chain. We'll connect this to thermodynamics, looking at how electrons move to lower energy at each step along the chain. For a quick review of thermodynamics, remember that Gibbs free energy is a measure of the total energy that can be harnessed to do work, and is a way to quantify the spontaneity of a process. Just like rocks naturally roll downhill, all processes naturally tend to go toward lower energy, which is higher stability. Spontaneous processes start at high energy and move toward lower energy, resulting in a negative delta G, which is defined as G final minus G initial. These processes release energy, which can dissipate into the surroundings as heat or be harnessed to do work. Non-spontaneous reactions go from low to high energy, have a positive delta G, and require energy to be put into the system. Remember that thermodynamics says nothing about the rate at which a reaction will occur, because spontaneity does not tell us about the path between initial and final states. Spontaneity does not tell us about activation energy. How do both redox and thermodynamics apply to the electron transport chain? In the electron transport chain, electrons are passed from one place to the next. They start at NADH or FADH2, which are molecules that have a relatively low affinity for electrons. Affinity is a measure of how tightly something is held. In this case, NADH and FADH2 don't hold electrons particularly tightly. Think about NADH. NADH passes its electrons to NADH dehydrogenase complex, a large membrane-bound protein on the inner mitochondrial membrane. The iron 3+ ions in NADH dehydrogenase complex have a higher electron affinity than does NADH. So when NADH collides with NADH dehydrogenase, NADH easily gives up its electrons to the iron 3+ ions in the center of the protein. As NADH gives up its electrons, it's oxidized to NAD+ and ready to participate again in glycolysis and the citric acid cycle. As NADH dehydrogenase gains electrons, the iron 3+ ions are reduced to iron 2+. Why do electrons move from NADH to NADH dehydrogenase complex and not the reverse? It's all about electron affinity and thermodynamics. When electrons are more tightly held, they're more stable. For example, in the redox tutorial, we saw that iron 2+ will give up an electron to silver plus because the overall delta G of the reaction is negative. In other words, neutral silver and iron 3+ have lower energy than do iron 2+ and silver plus. This is because silver has a higher electron affinity than does iron 2+, so the electron is more stable when silver has it than when iron 2+ has it. Likewise, NADH dehydrogenase complex has a higher electron affinity than does NADH, so electrons will move to NADH dehydrogenase complex, reaching lower energy and thus greater stability. This is a spontaneous process with a negative delta G because it results in more stable products. As an analogy, think about water in a series of pools. Water in this top pool will spontaneously fall down to water in the next pool. Here, the water is more stable. The water has a higher affinity, so to speak, for the lower pool because if possible, it'll move toward that lower pool. So we can equate low stability with high free energy and low electron affinity. Higher stability is lower free energy and higher electron affinity. Just as water would not spontaneously move from this lower pool back to the top pool, electrons would not spontaneously move from NADH dehydrogenase complex back to NADH. A similar process happens all down the electron transport chain. At every point, electrons flow in one direction because they move toward higher electron affinity, which is lower free energy and higher stability. While the protein complexes all have iron ions in them, the interaction between the iron and the protein is different in each protein, which changes electron affinity. so the iron ions in each complex have a different electron affinity. The iron in the cytochrome BC1 complex has a higher electron affinity than does iron in NADH dehydrogenase complex. Movement of electrons in this direction is spontaneous because the delta G of each step is negative. Processes with a negative delta G release energy, and this energy is harnessed to pump hydrogen ions from the mitochondrial matrix into the intermembrane space. In the last step of the chain, electrons are passed to oxygen. An oxygen atom from O2 gas gains 2 electrons and combines with 2 hydrogen ions to form water. Oxygen has the highest electron affinity, so electrons only move toward oxygen and never back to cytochrome oxidase. Compare NADH with FADH2. NADH drops electrons off at NADH dehydrogenase complex, while FADH2 drops electrons off at ubiquinone. Which do you think has a higher electron affinity, NADH or FADH2? FADH2, which drops its electrons off lower down in the chain. It would be like a pool somewhere here between NADH dehydrogenase and ubiquinone. But the proteins aren't necessarily in a line in the membrane. They can diffuse in that lipid bilayer. Despite this, electrons don't skip any steps. For example, they don't move from NADH dehydrogenase complex straight to cytochrome oxidase complex. While this movement would be spontaneous, moving from lower to higher electron affinity, these proteins aren't able to interact with each other in a way that allows electrons to move. Because of the shape and orientation of each player in the electron transport chain, electrons must be passed stepwise in this order. As you can see, each step along the electron transport chain reaches higher electron affinity, lower energy, and greater stability. This drives the process in one direction. The difference in affinity from one step to the next is pretty small, which allows the energy released to be harnessed to pump hydrogen ions. If electrons moved from low to high affinity all at once, too much energy would be released in one step, and only a fraction of it would be harnessed to pump hydrogen ions across the membrane. The rest of the energy would be released as heat and unable to be stored for cellular work. So why pump hydrogen ions across the membrane? This creates an electrochemical gradient that stores energy. We've seen an example of energy storage with ATP, in which energy is stored in covalent bonds between phosphate groups. Pushing those negatively charged atoms together stores potential energy. Likewise, storing hydrogen ions all on one side of the membrane stores potential energy. This is because all atoms and molecules move to fill the most space possible. Think about a drop of food coloring in a glass of water. The molecules that make up food coloring don't all stay together in one place, at least not for long. They spread out in the water, coloring all of it. This happens spontaneously, and the reason is entropy. There aren't many ways to arrange the food coloring molecules when they're all in the same place. But there are more ways to arrange the food coloring molecules if the molecules are randomly spread out in the entire glass of water. So the diffusion of the food coloring has a positive change in entropy. There's more randomness when the molecules are diffused than when they're all in one drop. This is spontaneous. Hydrogen ions also move to fill the most space possible. Inside mitochondria, there are two compartments, the mitochondrial matrix and the intermembrane space. The citric acid cycle occurs in the matrix, so this is where the majority of NADH and FADH2 are made. As electrons are passed from those molecules through the electron transport chain, hydrogen ions are pumped into the intermembrane space. The inner mitochondrial membrane, this membrane here, is not freely permeable to hydrogen ions, so hydrogen ions can't simply move back into the matrix to spread out. Instead, the hydrogen ions accumulate in one space, storing potential energy. Some hydrogen ions would, if they could, move across the inner mitochondrial membrane so that the concentration of hydrogen ions is the same on either side. That movement would be spontaneous and thus would release energy. In addition to the tendency to spread out, these positively charged ions repel each other because like charges repel each other. Just as the repulsion of negatively charged phosphate groups in ATP stores potential energy, the repulsion of positively charged hydrogen ions stores potential energy. The mitochondrial matrix has fewer hydrogen ions, so it is relatively negative compared to the intermembrane space. Positive charges are attracted to negative charges, so the hydrogen ions in the intermembrane space would, if they could, flow toward the more negatively charged matrix. These two factors, the electrical accumulation of like charges and the chemical accumulation of atoms in one space, make the electrochemical gradient. It's like water behind a dam. The water is backed up in one space, storing potential energy. If it could, that water would move down into the river below. That movement would be toward lower energy, so the process would release energy. With the help of turbines or water wheels, the energy can be harnessed to do work. Hydrogen ions are allowed to cross the inner mitochondrial membrane at ATP synthase. Here's a zoomed-in version of ATP synthase. Because the concentration of hydrogen ions is higher in the intermembrane space, hydrogen ions flow from the intermembrane space into the mitochondrial matrix. As they do so, they reach lower potential energy and thus lower free energy. The energy released in this spontaneous process is harnessed to drive the rotation of ATP synthase. The kinetic energy of the rotation of ATP synthase is then used to force ADP and inorganic phosphate together, forming ATP.